60 today. So last week, we saw the psalmist cries for help as he called out to God for deliverance from his enemies. And we looked at how we also can cry out for help in times of our great need. And the text today continues that theme of the psalmist calling out to God. And it gets more specific about the nature of God's deliverance or salvation. And what I want to do today, because I think, first of all, it was easy to do with this text. But secondly, I think it's just healthy every now and then to revisit the nature of our salvation and what was all involved in our salvation. And as I was reading through this text and looking at it, studying it, it just really struck me, all that's in here that reminds us of the nature of our salvation. So if you'd please stand, I'll read those scriptures, beginning in verse 153. Look on my affliction and deliver me, for I do not forget your law. Plead my cause and redeem me. Give me life according to your promise. Salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes. Great is your mercy, O Lord. Give me life according to your rules. Many are my persecutors and my adversaries, but I do not swerve from your testimonies. I look at the faithless with disgust because they do not keep your commands. Consider how I love your precepts. Give me life according to your steadfast love. The sum of your words is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. You can be seated. So the psalmist here continues to pray for God's deliverance from the enemies that are pursuing him, and he focuses on the salvation that he expects and that he is actually certain that he will receive. So in God's word is where we find salvation through and only through Jesus Christ. So let's look at these scriptures and see how these verses remind us of the salvation. I'm going to walk through today really just a very basic step-by-step outline of the process of our salvation and all that that entailed. First thing I want you to see is that we are wicked and in danger of God's judgment, and we do need deliverance. We are wicked as human beings. We are in danger of God's judgment, and we need deliverance. Look at verse 153. He says, look on my affliction and deliver me, for I do not forget your law. Now, of course, again, the context here is he's being pursued by enemies, but for today, let's parallel this danger with the dangers of our true enemies, which I have actually mentioned in previous sermons in this series. Our true enemies primarily being Satan and even our sin, our own personal sin, and God's, or the danger of God's judgment in our sin. So because we are all sinners, all human beings are sinners, only He can deliver us. God has no other option if He's going to save sinners but to do it Himself, because there's no one that He can look out in humanity and say, this person has the ability to be the Savior of the world. This is the truth that we see in Isaiah chapter 59. In Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, it's written, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened, that it cannot save, or His ear dull, that it cannot hear. But your iniquities, or your sin, have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden His face from you, so that He does not hear. So because of our sin and our unwillingness to repent, it's not that God is unable to save us. It is because of the lack, and I'm talking humanity in general, the lack of our repentance, the lack of our willingness to confess our sin. He is not willing to forgive us because we have not yet come to the point where we recognize that we need Him. Then look at verse 153 again, and as you read this, perhaps you can remember the day in which you came to faith in Christ. He says, look on my affliction and deliver me. That is really a basic statement of salvation. Whether or not you uttered those words when you came to faith in Christ, that is what your heart's cry was, is when you finally came to a realization of your sin. You said, look on my affliction, look on my sin, look on my need, and Lord, I need you to deliver me. Now look at verse 155. Salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes. So the psalmist here is referring to his enemies, that they are far from God, and the reason that he knows they're far from God is because they have no desire to seek God or His statutes or to follow God's word. They've rebelled against God, and they have not yet recognized their need for God, and they care nothing for the ways of God. And this is all of us before we come to faith in Christ. As we think about our own salvation, we put ourselves, or we have to put ourselves, in the state of the wicked before we came to faith in Christ. The categories and the descriptions of us in our unredeemed state as human beings is not flattering. For example, Jeremiah 17:9 says that our hearts are desperately wicked. In Romans chapter 5 and chapter 6, we are called enemies of God. We are called slaves to sin. It says that we have earned God's wrath. Ephesians 2 even says that we are children or objects of God's wrath. There are many more descriptions. Perhaps one of the most detailed descriptions of the nature of our sinfulness before we come to faith in Christ is in Romans chapter 3, verses 10 through 18. It says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. Not one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of snakes is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. And their paths are ruin and misery. All the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. We look at that and we say, as Christians, amen, because we see that going on around us in our culture and around the world. But let's not forget, that is who we were in our unredeemed state. If you've not come to faith in Christ, that is who you are. In Isaiah 59, which I mentioned earlier, I want to read verses 1 through 13, because I think Isaiah 59, I call it the Romans 3 of the Old Testament, because you hear a very similar description of the sinfulness of mankind. As God is looking on to mankind, here's what he says. As I read before, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. His ear is not dull that it cannot hear. But your iniquities or your sins have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. And then the rest of it describes the sinfulness of humanity. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongue mutters wickedness. No one enters suit justly. No one goes to law honestly. They rely on empty pleas. They speak lies. They conceive mischief and give birth to iniquity. They hatch snake eggs. They weave the spider's web. He who eats their eggs dies. And from one that is crushed, a viper is hatched. Their webs will not serve as clothing. Men will not cover themselves with what they made. Their works are works of iniquity. Their deeds of violence are in their hands. Their feet run to evil. And they are swift to shed innocent blood, and their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Desolation and destruction are their highways. The way of peace they do not know. There is no justice in their paths. They have made their roads crooked. No one who treads on them knows peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not overtake us. We hope for light and behold darkness, and for brightness we walk in gloom. We grope for the wall like the blind. We grope like those who have no eyes. We stumble at noon as in the twilight. Among those in full vigor, we are like dead men. We all growl like bears. We moan and moan like doves. We hope for justice, but there is none. For salvation, but it is far from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquities, transgressing and denying the Lord and turning back from following our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart lying words. Now that was God speaking to his own people, okay, and the sin that they had fallen in. And it's I would perhaps call it an even greater description in some ways, I guess at least a more broad description of what we hear about in Rome, or what we read about in Romans 3. I think we just need to be reminded that the world is made up 100% of wicked people. They're not good people and bad people. There are bad people, and that is it. I've also told you, when somebody says, don't you believe good people go to heaven? I say, sure, I believe good people go to heaven. Absolutely. There's just one problem. There are no good people. There's no such thing biblically as a good person. There's one of the things that we've, especially over the last, I guess, month or so, we've kind of, a lot of us have watched a lot of news and seen what's going on, and just the chaos and the things that many of us never thought we'd see, and all of these things that we see going on TV, and kind of the wickedness of the world and the wickedness of people just kind of unfolding before our eyes. And it's really kind of shocking. But you know what's more shocking than everything that we see on television and everything that's going on? What's more shocking is that Christians are shocked by it. That's the most shocking thing, that we're actually shocked by it. Why should we be shocked by what we're seeing happen? I mean, that's humanity. That's who humanity is. When you throw off restraints and people feel as if they can get away with things, and that is humanity. And before you start judging all the people you're seeing, that is your heart on display before you came to faith in Christ. And if you say, no, that was not, that was never me, well, I would just humbly tell you then you don't believe what the Bible says about you. Because that's what the Bible says you are and who you are in your unredeemed state. So I'm not saying it's easy to watch. I'm not saying we should be okay with it, but I don't see any reason to be shocked by it. I mean, it shouldn't even really phase us as Christians. Like, I can't believe this is happening. Of course it's happening. This is read the Bible and all the stuff people did and the history of the world and all that's happened. That is humanity. There are no good people. There's nothing good about us. We've been made in the image of God, but we've now been corrupted through our sin. So there is no good people, bad people, more righteous people than others. We are all equally wicked. And as I was telling someone actually just yesterday, you know, one of the things that I think we have to remember is we tend to compare ourselves to people, which unfortunately is wrong, because God compares everybody to himself. That's why the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Not some are better than others. Because the only comparison we will be compared to is God himself. So going back to Isaiah 59, it says in verse 16, rightfully after this description, it says that God saw no man, no one who could intercede on behalf of man. So what happened? It says his own arm brought salvation. So God essentially looks out among humanity, sees the sinfulness of humanity, says, there's nobody I can trust here or has the capability to save sinners, because everybody that I'm looking at is in the same situation. They all deserve my judgment. So that leads us to the second point. And that is that if we're going to have salvation, if we're going to be redeemed, if we're going to have eternal life, it comes as a gift of God's grace, really brought on by himself, his own personal action in and of himself, independent of any of us. Look at verse 154. Psalmist says, plead my cause and redeem me. Give me life according to your promise. Now think about this. This is an interesting thing the psalmist says here. Plead my cause. Who is God supposed to plead the psalmist's cause to? And when we think of somebody pleading somebody's cause, if I tell you plead my cause, I'm telling you to intercede on my behalf, to go to a higher person of authority. Okay? And here the psalmist looks at God and says, plead my cause. Well, who is God going to plead the psalmist's cause to? Who is greater than God that God would go to them and plead his cause? And of course, the answer is no one. No one's greater than God. God need not plead to anyone higher than himself, nor can God plead to anyone higher than himself, because he is the greatest, highest, and most powerful holy being. So this is where the incarnation of Jesus comes into play. The fact that God became flesh and died on the cross to redeem us, that he was buried and raised from the dead. In Isaiah 59, verse 16, I just read earlier, God had to redeem man himself. Okay, his own arm had to reach down and save mankind. And so he couldn't choose a person out there to save mankind. So what does he do? He says, I'm going to have to do this myself. And so he puts on flesh, comes in the man of Jesus Christ, dies on the cross, is buried, is raised from the dead, and secures the salvation. Completely and totally an independent act of God on behalf of sinners, apart from any help from sinners. In Romans chapter 3:16, Paul writes that God is both the just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. God is the just in that he judged sin, mankind's sin, in the flesh of Jesus Christ when Jesus died on the cross. But he is also the justifier in that Jesus, as God in the flesh, was the one who secured our salvation before God. And so when John writes in 1 John chapter 2, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate or a mediator, the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. You see how he does? He says, we have a mediator, an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation. He's the one that satisfied God's wrath for our sins. And not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So it was God and God alone and God himself through Jesus Christ who secured our salvation. So our salvation is secured not because we earn it, because we deserve it, not because we work with God in tandem to participate in it, to do a little bit that we need to do to make sure we're saved. It is completely a work of God. Look at verse 156. your mercy, O Lord, give me life according to your rules. God's mercy is great. Life, eternal life, comes according to God's rules. God's word, God's plan, the gospel. Okay, have you ever been playing a card game or a board game with a group of people? And somebody will say, hey, let's play Monopoly. Okay, and I don't know a lot of board games or card games because I don't really like any of them. I play Uno with Bryce. That's about as far as I go. Okay. But I have been in a situation, let's play a game. Do you all know how to play Monopoly or do you know how to play this card game? Sure, we play that. And then you start playing and somebody says, wait a minute, you can't do that. What do you mean I can't do that? Well, that's not right. That's not the rules. Well, that's the way I played it growing up. That's the way I was taught to play it. Well, that's not the way I was taught to play it. So then what do? You pull out what? The instructions. Well, let's see what the rules are. And most of the time you find out what? You're both wrong, okay? Because you were raised a certain way to play this game one way, and you were raised to play a game another way, and then you actually read the rules, and you realize we're both wrong, you know? And then, you know, I don't know if you arm wrestle over whose rules wins, but sometimes you just go, well, that's the rules, and so we'll just all agree to play by the rules. Well, essentially what humanity has done is they've kind of created their own rules, okay? And they've acted like the gospel is something you can turn a little bit or twist a little bit, change a little bit. When God has said, no, if you're going to come to me, if you're going to have eternal life, you come by my rules. You don't invent other ways to God. And if that seems narrow, it's true. It is narrow, and Jesus admitted that. He confessed that in Matthew chapter 7. He says, the way to him or the way to eternal life was narrow, saying that most people are not going to find it. Most people are not going to agree to follow it. They're going to want to go their own way. There's going to be a lot of people that go that way. That path is broad. The people that decide to do it my way, which is through faith in Jesus Christ, or Jesus saying this faith in himself, is very narrow. Jesus said in John 14:6, a very popular scripture, that he was the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through him. An extremely narrow statement. So if we come to salvation, if we come to the point of eternal life, we do it by God's way and God's way only, or it doesn't happen. You don't get to twist the rules, change the rules, make up your own rules. You know, some of us don't even, we just make up games. You know, that's really what people do. Now, kids do that all the time. They make up games. You know, and then they tell you the rules, and then you start winning, and what do? They change the rules because they're not winning. So that's what humanity does. We make up the way we think life should be. And then all this isn't working for us in this situation, so I'm going to now change the rules again. Okay? This is not the way that God works. He says, if you want to come to me, if you want to be saved by me, if you want to have eternal life, it's through the gospel. And it's through Christ and through Christ alone. Look at verse 159. The psalmist says, consider how I love your precepts. Give me life according to your steadfast love. Unconditional, unearned, unmerited, eternal love is what moves the heart of God to save sinners. It's what moved Jesus Christ to die for sinners. And it's what moves God today to save sinners. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish. In other words, will not be judged, will not face God's wrath, but have eternal life. So God has chosen to love the unlovable. He's chosen to love his enemies, which may be something we want to keep in mind as we're watching everything that's going on in our culture. If we're going to call ourselves followers of Jesus, if we're going to call ourselves Christians and people of the gospel, we have to remind ourselves the gospel is about loving the unlovable. Okay? It's about pursuing the unlovable. It's not about distancing ourselves. It's about getting next to them. It's about walking near them. It's about, you know, loving them. You know, it's about seeking them out. That is the nature of the gospel. That's what Christ has done for us. He's chosen to love us despite the descriptions that we see of who we are in Ephesians 1 and Romans 3 and Isaiah 59 that I read earlier. Now, I want you to see the key word in all the three verses I just read and in John 3:16. Verse 154, God, he says, give me life according to your promise. Verse 156, give me life according to your rules. Verse 159, give me life according to your steadfast love. And even John 3:16 said, whoever believes in Christ will have eternal life. So if we desire eternal life, if we desire God to grant us life, it has to come through the way that he has said that it will come, and that is through Christ. Listen to what is written in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 to 20, about the choices regarding life and how it's the choice of life and death, the choice of eternal life and eternal death, is based on whether or not you choose to submit to and follow what God has said. It says, "See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you were going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, and you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your forefathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them." So the psalmist calls out to God for life. Okay, and that is the option of choosing Christ or rejecting Christ. It's life and death. And the promise that comes with choosing Christ is eternal life, what might be worded here as length of days. It's also the promise you'll see that you will love the Lord your God, obey his voice, and hold fast to him or stay close to him. That is a gift that God grants you with salvation. It's not just eternal life that he grants you. It's then putting the Spirit in you. He grants you the desire to walk with God and obey God. And for those that would say, well, I could never imagine being a Christian because I could never, you know, imagine wanting to do the things that Christians want to do. Well, that's because your want-tos are all messed up, okay, in your unredeemed state, all right? And God has to restore the original want-tos back that were in the Garden of Eden that draw you close to God before sin came into the world. But eternal life is only guaranteed when you obey the gospel, all right, only in trusting in Christ. That brings us to the third point, which is the gospel is the only message of salvation. In verse 157 and 158, "Many are my persecutors and my adversaries, but I do not swerve from your testimonies. I look at the faithless with disgust because they do not keep your commandments. So the wicked go their own way, leading only to destruction. But the psalmist has made up his mind, I've chosen to follow God in his ways." And then verse 160 says, "The sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever." So every word of the Bible is true, and every word of the Bible endures forever. And God does not change, and his word does not change. And because God does not change, and he has laid out his Bible, his word, we know that the Bible does not change as well. The psalmist said in verse 152 of this psalm, "Long have I known from your testimonies that you have founded them forever." In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it records Jesus saying, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away." So God's word, God does not adjust his word or his expectations based on culture or what's going on culturally or what's going on around the world or the latest fads. Okay, God doesn't adjust to us. Now, sometimes humanity adjusts away from God, sees his statutes, his rules, what he expects, and we decide to go a different way. When human beings adjust in that way, it's called rebellion. It's called sin. Because the standard of truth has not moved. The standard of truth is set. Humanity does not have the right to move the standard of truth. Right? The same gospel message that saved the early Christians, the same belief in Jesus and his resurrection that saved people we see in the New Testament, the same gospel that saved people through some of the great awakenings through history is the same gospel that saves people today. There is no other message capable of bringing humanity to God. We are not more enlightened today to have discovered a different, better way to know God. God has still said, if want to, if you want to be forgiven by me, if you want to know eternal life, it comes one way and one way only, and that's through my Son, Jesus Christ. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I will remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Now he's saying you claim to believe this message. Okay, if you hold fast to it, it proves you have believed the message. He says, for I deliver to you of first importance what I also received. He said, I'm just passing a message that came to me. All right, this is the Apostle Paul writing. He said, I'm preaching the same message that Jesus preached to me on the road to Damascus and that Ananias preached to me after he helped me recover from the road to Damascus experience. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. And then Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3:16 that the sacred scriptures or the sacred writings were able to help Timothy be wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. So the gospel and all that the gospel proclaims, sin, the sinfulness of mankind, God's judgment on sin and sinful mankind, the substitutionary death of Jesus, his burial, his resurrection, the hope and forgiveness that we can have through Christ, all of this remains the same. All of it is recorded in Scripture. There is no other message that is able to reconcile man to God. It's only the gospel, and the gospel is found in the Bible. Now, many of you may have seen the movie National Treasure 2, Book of Secrets. Okay? If you have, you'll remember it's a story of a treasure hunter named Ben Gates. He was played by Nicolas Cage. And he's trying to clear his great-great-grandfather's name because he's been told that his great-great-grandfather was actually a major player in the assassination of President Lincoln. Okay? And he doesn't believe it. So he sets out to basically clear his family name, that they had nothing to do with the assassination of President Lincoln. And in this search, he's told that some clues that he needs are in this book of secrets. This secret book that's supposedly only given from president to president, and it's hidden somewhere. Okay, and so he's looking, first of all, to see if this book exists, to find out where it is, to see if he can gain access to it, and then to look in this book to see if it has the clues that he needs to get to the point where he clears his great-great-grandfather's name. Now, the problem with finding this book and the reason it's hidden is because it contains all kinds of answers to mysteries and secrets that could change the world. At one point, his sidekick basically opens up and says, hey, would you guys like to know who killed JFK? You know, like apparently that was revealed in the book. And then what about Area 51 and aliens? And all those things are supposed to be in this book. And so the book is hidden because, and they really protect the book even when he finds out and clears his great-great-grandfather's name, because they know if the message of this book and the truth of this book gets out, it will absolutely turn the world upside down. And it doesn't seem to be like it would be in a positive way. So they hide it. Okay? Now, in some ways, this is very similar to the Bible, in that we have a book that contains the explanation of a mystery. Okay, God's love for sinners, the crucifixion of Christ, the incarnate God-man who came and died on a cross. And so we have this book that explains this incredible mystery that has the ability, and in many ways has, changed the world. Now, of course, the big difference is, this book is not meant to be hidden. This book is meant to be explained. It's meant to get to as many people as possible so that they too can have access to the explanation of this mystery. That is why the Bible is so important, because it contains the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's why we get it in the hands of people even after they come to faith in Christ. In other countries where they don't have Bibles in their language, we try to quickly translate the Bible, because we know if they read the Bible, they can come to faith in Christ. And even if they accept the gospel before they have a translation, we know that the Bible basically unpacks this mystery of God's love for sinners and redemption of mankind. But let us never forget that we are wicked and deserving God's judgment and in need of deliverance. We need a massive dose of humility in the church. We need a massive dose of recognizing from which we came and that we are not better than anybody else. We're not worse, but we're not better. Okay? That will lead to empathy and sympathy, the ability to relate to people, the ability to better communicate the gospel, as long as people see us as kind of on a higher plane, acting as if we're better than everybody else. It's very difficult to communicate. We don't need to be ashamed of our salvation in any way. Okay, but the point of Christianity is not to point people to our righteousness. The point of Christianity is to point people to Christ's righteousness. We have no answers in and of ourselves. We only share with them the answer that we found in Christ. We have to share that deliverance is only available by the grace of God in Jesus Christ. There is no other way to be made whole. There is no other way to be forgiven. There is no other way to have confidence of eternal life. There is no other way to have security that you will avoid God's judgment apart from Jesus Christ. I told one person, it's been a while back now, they just kind of made an offside comment and said, well, I don't need Jesus. I don't feel like I need Jesus. My comment back to them was, you're not dead yet. Your tune might change when you die. And then the Bible holds the message. The Bible holds the message. If you'd bow your heads. Of course, the key question here is, have you put your faith in Christ? Have you come to the point where you have confessed you're a sinner, admitted your need, cried out as the psalmist did here, and look on my affliction, Lord, and deliver me. I'm an afflicted, needy person. I know my sin. I need forgiveness of my sin. And call on Christ to save you, to recognize that He is the only way by which you can be forgiven. And if you haven't, I would encourage you to do that today. God never pushes away sinners who are willing to admit their sinfulness. It's amazing that a holy, righteous God would welcome sinners as long as they're willing to admit their need and their sinfulness. But for the prideful and the arrogant, to those who don't think they need God, to those who think they can in some way achieve it themselves, God has no interest. He's not going to change the rules for you. He's not going to change the rule just because you have a different preference of the way you want to play the game. So you have to admit you're a sinner. You have to believe Jesus Christ was the God-man who died on the cross for your sins, taking your place, being your substitute, taking on God's judgment on Himself so you would not have to pay for it, that He was buried, raised from the dead, and He has secured everything that needed to be secured for salvation. For the rest of us, my hope is that just something in what was said in these scriptures today reminds you of the story of salvation that is true in your own life. You know, that something adds some spark to the fire in your heart that you have for Christ to recognize this incredible act of God on your behalf, reaching out to you who could not save yourself, dead in your sins, unable to even respond to God, unable to even seek God apart from Him, working in your heart and drawing you to Himself. You were totally helpless, completely wicked, absolutely deserving of hell. And yet God in His mercy reached out to you, worked in your heart, drew you to Himself, opened your eyes so you can see what Paul says, the light of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to embrace Jesus Christ. And it was all His work and none of yours. And celebrate it and enjoy it and then share it. Father, we are not as grateful as we should be for our salvation. But at what level of gratitude that we have, we want to make sure that we confess that before You. And we want to make sure, and we want to pray for Your mercy, that You would increase that gratitude and even that sense of awe of what it means to be a sinner saved by grace. That it would motivate us to share with others. Lord, that it would help us communicate, that it would make us more humble, that it would help us to reach out to those that normally we might not want to reach out to, that it would help us to love people that in and of ourselves we want to hate, but that would move us toward compassion as You looked out into the fields and had compassion for people because they didn't have a shepherd. And Your prayer was that we would be, and that God would send, Your Father would send laborers into the field. And that's who You've called us to be. So let us be aware of every aspect of the gospel the nature of our sinfulness and the depth of it, our helplessness, your grace, your mercy, your love, the security we have in Christ, all of the facts of the gospel and the truth of the gospel. Let us be keenly aware of it, that it may impact every part of our lives. And we pray these things.